Greetings. I welcome you who are gathered in the sanctuary this morning, as well as those who are worshiping virtually, as we join in one spirit together as St. Luke's United Church of Christ in Independence, Missouri. Today is the second Sunday of Advent. This season is a time of preparation for the coming light of God seen in the birth of the Christ child. As part of our weekly worship during Advent, we will be lighting the candles again today of the Advent wreath, candles that shine with the presence of hope, peace, joy, and love that Christ came to make known to us. Today we will be lighting the candle of peace as we hear the cry of John the Baptist calling us to prepare the way for the Lord. If you are worshiping virtually, I encourage you to light candles in your home, reminding you that the presence and light of God is for all people and shines upon you wherever you may be. I hope that you will actively engage throughout this season, whatever way you can, in preparing for the coming of Christ among us as we share and worship together at St. Luke's. Holy Communion will also be included as part of today's worship service. And in the UCC, we practice an open table. That means regardless of denominational affiliation or congregational membership, you are invited and encouraged to participate in communion as we receive communion together. Those in the sanctuary should have found individually packaged communion elements at the doors as you entered the sanctuary. If not, you may get those now before we get to communion in the service. Those who are worshiping virtually are encouraged to gather something where you are to serve as elements of communion, a cracker or a bagel, a piece of bread, wine, juice, or even coffee, and have those available and ready as we celebrate communion together. Home communion celebrates and attests to the assurance that the peace of God is all-pervasive and surely abides in our own homes or wherever we may be. I encourage you throughout the service to engage as fully as possible, exchange comments with one another and greetings with one another, whether in the sanctuary or virtually, as we worship. I encourage you to follow the worship readings as we go through, and online hosts are available and ready to answer any questions that you might have during the service. I invite you to share your prayer requests in the comments as well. Like or share the service on your Facebook page and welcome others, invite others to worship along with us. Opportunities for electronic giving can be accessed in the QR code, in the pews, in the bulletin, or on the live stream. By way of announcements, today is our final day for the campaign for holiday helpers that will be shared with Independent School District's Holiday Helper Campaign. We hope that you have remembered and will want to contribute to that project. Next Sunday will be a special day of worship at St. Luke's. I hear it's right on schedule because there's rain or ice or snow predicted on Saturday, so stay tuned for that. But Sunday, as never fails, is scheduled to be the Christmas pageant from the children. The night the animals sang. So we will look forward to that. And that will be next Sunday during worship service. And hope that you will share in that time of supporting the kids and allowing them to bring us the week of Advent joy. The Salvation Army bell ringers are needed for December the 18th. We have still two slots open if you are available on that day and can fill in. The sign-up sheet is in the hallway as you leave the sanctuary, or there's a sign-up on windows. Keep that in mind if you can help at all. And back by popular demand is the Advent Sanctuary experience. Last year, when we could not safely gather for in-person worship, part of our Advent experience was the opportunity to come to the sanctuary and sit alone as family groups and just appreciate the sights and the sounds of Advent. And we had pre-recorded music from Matthew and Margie that you could listen to and sit in quietness and reflection for an Advent time Folks have asked, even though we are back in person, if we will have that opportunity again. So we're going to respond by offering that. It's more of an open house opportunity this year. You won't have to sign up. The church will be open on December the 21st. I believe that's a Tuesday, from 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock. And you can just come and go. You don't have to have reservations. We're not as concerned about that part of the protocol at this point in the pandemic. But it'll be an open house format just for you to sit to appreciate this, the sights and the sounds of Advent. So keep that in mind if you would, something that you would benefit from and enjoy doing. And now from all the places we may be, in one spirit, let us focus our hearts and minds on the worship of our God.
Please join me this morning as we light the second Advent candle. Voices cry out from the wilderness.
Prepare the way of the Holy One. Prepare for the glory of God to be revealed and God's peace to rise like the dawn among us.
This peace may not be easy if it means that mountains will come crashing down and rough places will be ground to dust to make a way.
Yet God wants restored Jerusalem.
Gathering exiles in his arms, carrying them home in safety.
Peace has happened before.
Today, on this second Sunday of Advent, we light a candle of peace as a sign of the approaching sunrise, a reminder that we are called to prepare the way for peace.
Making a highway through the desert of the world's violence, comforting God's people, speaking tenderly to those who are wounded.
And though the way of peace may be hard, peace itself is coming toward us. God comes with might, with an outstretched arm, reaching up helplessly from a manger. Let us pray together. Loving God,
you provide
a mighty peace even amid trouble. As we light these candles, place your deep peace in us that we may help to make a way. Risking peace each day for your sake and the sake of your realm of peace. We pray this in the name of Jesus and the Holy Spirit who guides us. Amen. Call to confession. We are called to catch a vision of God's promised peace that shall come on earth. We can only begin to imagine it. How can we be part of making the promise of peace a reality? Peace on earth begins with peace in our relationships with one another. Peace with one another begins with being at peace within ourselves, and that begins with peace, being at peace with God. Let us confess our sin and find peace with God, with ourselves, and with one another. Amen. Join me in the prayer of confession. Loving God, even in the midst of this season of goodwill and holiday cheer, stress and anxiety rule our lives. We are missing your peace. We fail to think about your reordered world, a world where the lowly are lifted up and the hungry are filled with good things. Forgive us and grant us your peace that we might join with you in preparing a world that welcomes the one who brings us peace. Amen. Amen.
The promises of God are fulfilled. God does not forget us. God's mercy extends to generation to generation. Let our souls rejoice in God.
Thank you.
may be seated. It's time for Moments with Minnie. My friends, my very best friends are coming to join me. We've got a special guest today, along with Minnie Mouse, to introduce. So, here's everybody. And I want to talk to you about next Sunday, your pageant. I want to just cheer a little bit. Riley, you said you're going to be a cow in the pageant?
Yes.
A sheep. Sheep, that's right. You like cows, but you're going to be a sheep.
Hey.
All right, yeah.
I'm going to be a cow.
You're going to be a cow?
Yeah, I'm going to be a mouse.
You're a mouse?
No, I'm a mouse.
Oh, what?
A mice?
A mice? Are you going to be like Minnie?
No.
No? Different kind of mice.
Minnie's not a mice.
Well, Minnie's not a mice? Well, what is she?
She has a tail.
She's got a tail. But cows have tails.
Yeah. The mice only have black tails.
Oh, okay.
That means she's a mice, too.
That means she's a mice.
What's that?
Well, this guy... There's different characters in the pageant, right? You have the shepherds, right?
Yeah.
Going to be some shepherds.
What's he called?
I'm going to tell you. I'm going to get there. There's shepherds in the play, in the pageant, and there's magi or wise men, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the play, and there's a baby. What's the baby's name?
Jesus.
Baby Jesus, yeah. Baby Jesus and Mary, his mom, right? And Joseph. But is this guy going to be in your pageant? Anybody look like that? His name is John.
John.
He's a woolly bugger, isn't he? Yeah, that's John. And he doesn't look like an angel, does he? He doesn't look like any angel you've ever seen? Nope. But he's a character. He's one of my favorite characters in the Christmas story. You know why I like John? What? Yeah. Why I like John is he reminds me we don't have to be angels. We don't have to be special in any kind of way. We just have to be ourselves. And when we are ourselves, when we be who God wants us to be, there's something that we can do in the story. There's some part that we can play. Yeah. We don't have to be an angel. There's a place for sheep and for cows and for mice.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a place even for people like John who just want to do their simple part. You don't got to dress up. You don't got to be somebody else. You just be yourself.
Look at my sweater.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That's a beautiful dress. All right, so let's pray that we will learn our parts for the pageant. So we'll do a good job, right? But let's pray, most of all, we'll learn our parts in life when we grow up, what God wants us to do and say and be to tell others about God's love for them. Okay? Thank you, God, for all of the characters and all of the animals in the Christmas story. And we pray for our children as they're getting ready to tell us the story of Christmas. But help us to know that we all have a part in telling the story. Just who we are, just the way we are, you can use us for a job that you have for us to do. Help us prepare for that most of all. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Thanks, guys. It's time now for us to join our hearts and spirits as we lift our needs and prayers to God. God of promise and God of peace, your glory is revealed to us day by day. We have seen places where our valleys of despair have been filled with hope. We have seen mountainous challenges be leveled before us. Your promises help us to look beyond whatever fear our situation may stir within us. You give us a glimpse of your good news of great joy, which is for all people. So today we seek your spirit to dwell among us, that we might proclaim your message of hope and be faithful to extend your hope and joy and peace. May our very lives reflect Christ's presence and bring your realm of peace to those who might be oppressed or who might stand in the shadow of isolation or fear, those who continue to be infected and affected by COVID-19, those who remain vulnerable to becoming ill or suffering impact that is a barrier to peace and joy. We pray for those whose darkness is real, as they sit in isolation of the margins, left out, left behind. May the light of your peace be seen in the message and mission of our lives and of our congregation. Let us lift our voices now and pray as our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The scripture reading this morning comes from Luke's Gospel, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. In the 15th year of the rule Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor over Judea and Herod was ruler over Galilee, his brother Philip was ruler over Etruria and Trachonitis, and Licinius was ruler over Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, God's word came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. John went throughout the region of the Jordan River, calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. This is just as it was written in the scroll of the words of Isaiah the prophet, "A voice crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make his paths straight. Every valley will be filled, and every mountain and hill will be leveled. The crooked will be made straight, and the rough places made smooth. All humanity will see God's salvation." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, he made his way into the text on the first Sunday of Advent, almost as an intrusion into the gospel narrative of light coming into the world. John the Baptist. John the Baptist and intrusion seem to go together. In fact, if you looked up the word intrusion in a Bible dictionary, you might find a picture of this woolly, rough, backwoods preacher. He is indeed not like the others in the Christmas story. But a simple mention in passing is not nearly enough intrusion for the likes of John the Baptist. He is a voice crying in the wilderness, a voice that would not fall silent, a voice that demanded a hearing. So let's hear what he has to say as we sit in the light of the candle of peace on the second Sunday of Advent. The third chapter of Luke's Gospel opens with what Luke, being the historian that he was, might have meant to be, well, a time stamp. Luke walks us through the names of those who sat in power so we would know where his story appears in the annals of history. In the 15th year of the ruler, Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor over Judea, and Herod was ruler over Galilee, and his brother Philip was ruler over Etruria and Trachonitis, and Licinius was ruler over Abilene. During the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, God's word came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. But Judith Jones tells us that Luke's litany of imperial, regional, and religious authorities does more than date John's ministry. It also makes a contrast between human kingdoms and God's reign. Once again, the message is clear. When it comes to John, one of these things is not like the others, and his message is just as different as he is. A closer comparison between the established powers and kingdoms which John was announcing says a lot about the two different kinds of kingdoms, but also sets the stage for the kind of peace that would characterize the approaching kingdom that John was proclaiming and which we seek to usher in anew today. The political era in which John, and Jesus along with him, emerged was known as the Pax Romana, or the Peace of Rome. Now, wars are often distinguished by name, but this was a peace that was being identified by name. But was it a peace at all? Well, it depends on who you ask. The Pax Romana was established by invasion, maintained by force. People were ruled by opposition and fear. It produced a very unstable social climate. It was very expensive and proved unsustainable. It was peace that inadvertently impacted countless of lives negatively. By setting John, who was not like the others, alongside them, the message is clear. The kingdom of which John spoke was also a different kind of kingdom. The peace he promised, The peace we're talking about today is also a very different kind of peace. Well, why the wilderness? Why was this John calling people into the wilderness? Why not into the cities, into the seats of power? Perhaps it is a matter of simple redirection, as if to say, if it is the kingdom of God you're looking for, it's time you turn your attention and focus away from all of the established seats of power. John was proclaiming a peace which Jesus would later describe as a peace the world cannot give. As we prepare the way for the Lord this Advent, it is John's voice that is calling us to our own wilderness place to seek a peace that the world, with all of its established power, cannot give. Ours is a peace that is born in a stable and laid in a manger. Peace on earth for all people. John extends more than an invitation. His is a summons to prepare the way for the Lord. Make his path straight. Every valley will be filled and every mountain and hill will be leveled. The crooked will be made straight and rough places made smooth. For John, this was not going to be an easy task. When he drew on the analogy of road building, of filling every valley and leveling every mountain and hill, he was not saying, bring in the heavy equipment. In John's day, there was no heavy equipment. He was saying something more like, grab a shovel and a bucket, start digging, and don't ever stop digging. He was talking about the rudiments of the slow, tedious, hard work of doing what seemed to be an endless task. Literally, moving mountains. Expounding on what John was calling to mind when he called his hearers to prepare the way, Lynn Miller offers an analysis of Gustav Courbet's painting entitled The Stonebreakers. In her work, Art and Faith, Lynn Miller says, talking about Courbet's painting, that Courbet captures the backbreaking process of 19th century road construction, showing two figures engaged in clearing stones from roadbeds and then breaking them into smaller pieces. The stones were turned into gravel for paving material and other uses. Miller says the two figures in the painting are anonymous. We would not be able to recognize either of the two workers should we meet them again. But they seem, in turn, too young and too old to be doing the demanding work. Courbet's realism refused to idealize any subject, so there is no golden glow of daylight, or of candles for that matter, or of oneness with nature. There's only work, pull, swing, chop, load, carry, dump, start over. Whether it is John the Baptist in the first century, the stone breakers in the 19th century, or those who are trying to make way for peace today, anonymously, tirelessly laboring to prepare the way of the coming of the Lord, it is the same realism. Seldom any glow of daylight or oneness with nature. Only work, hard work, pull, swing, chop, load, carry, dump, and start over. Maybe we have mistakenly assumed when it comes to preparing the way of the Lord, preparing the way for Advent's peace, that it is as easy as lighting a candle, holding a candle, or singing a song of peace. Not that those are empty efforts by any measure, but there comes a time when there is only work. Pull, swing, chop, load, carry, dump, and start all over. Grab a shovel and a bucket, start digging, and don't ever stop digging. How do we keep digging? How do we not grow discouraged? How do we not give up on peace? How do we even have the audacity to light another candle? The valleys of separation and division are widening, sucking more and more people into the dark gulch of conflict. Relationships get more crooked and tangled, with little progress being made to straighten the paths that would connect us to one another. Oppression, violence, and hate are mounting higher and higher. How shall they ever be brought down? It seems that we're getting nowhere. Maybe what Advent is calling for is a change in perspective, realism, a clarity that rings from the wilderness where new light and life are being proclaimed and ushered in. Maybe instead of looking at the immensity of the mountain to be moved, it's time for us to find a way to fill the bucket in our hand. What can we do to move some dirt to prepare the way for the Lord? How can the small things we do ever make an impact on the bigger picture? Advent is a call to awaken to the light that is breaking through the darkness in small, unexpected places, even in a lowly manger. In this year's Advent movie, A Wind at My Back Christmas, prevailing winds were shifting as Hitler's aggression was expanding in Europe. How could such evil be resisted, much less brought down? It would take large-scale intervention. But as Janet Hunt reminds us, seldom have I known big solution which has come to be without the back-breaking, soul-stretching work of doing it one step at a time, the sort that shapes values and deepens relationships. That pretty much sums up the plot of our Advent movie, how the Baileys, through their own soul-searching work, build a relationship with a young Jewish refugee, Anna Schaller, harboring her as she sought safety. For Christmas, Anna gave Hub Bailey a book of poems. The one that she had marked for Hub was entitled Auguries of Innocence by William Blake. It starts like this: to see a world in a grain of sand, and a heaven in a wildflower. Hold infinity in the palm of your hand, and eternity in an hour. Anyone can see the peace and the defeat of Hitler by the Allied armies. But as Blake was saying in his poem, when it comes to big things, concepts that seem to be beyond our comprehension or imagination, things like peace, look for them and prepare the way for them in the very small places and things around you. Maybe it's time to hold peace in your hand, to let the flame of one small candle shine for all eternity by focusing more fully on it this season. Maybe it's time to take a bucket into your hand and start digging and never stop digging, preparing the way of the Lord with simple, small, anonymous, unrelenting acts of peace. Coleman McCarthy is correct in saying, the earth is too small a star, and we too brief a visitor upon it, for anything to matter more than a struggle for peace. Amen.
Thank you.
When we see the needs of the world in which we live, we often wonder, why doesn't somebody do something? Maybe a better question would be, what can I do? When we devote our lives to God, however insignificant we may feel, and when we devote whatever resources we have to God, however limited they may be, God can and will bless all that we bring. Only faith can imagine what shall be done with the offerings we bring and the commitments we make today. I invite you to join me in prayer as we dedicate our lives and our gifts to God. God of love, you continue to bless us and sustain us with your presence and the blessings of your hand. We praise you and offer our thanks for all we have received. We rejoice in the good news of great joy for all people that has come in Christ, knowing that your promises will be fulfilled. We pledge our lives in anticipation of the coming one who brings us peace. Amen. Thanks, Ready. Okay. This table today is a call of invitation. It is the invitation that is extended in the songs of the angels when they sing, fear not. It is an invitation into the good news of God's light and mercy that has shined upon us in Christ. It is an invitation into the hope and healing of the nations. It is an invitation of great joy. It is an invitation for all people. It is an invitation for those who choose to hold the peace of Christ in your hand and in your heart. I invite you to join with me in the reading of the affirmation Renewal of Faith as printed in the bulletin and in the comments of the live stream. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death, God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. In the night that our Lord was betrayed, after the Passover feast, he took bread, he broke it, he gave it to his friends. He said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In a similar way, after the supper, our Lord took the cup and gave thanks and he blessed it. He said, "This cup is my blood, which is poured out for many. As oft as you drink from this cup, do this in remembrance of me." Come, Holy Spirit, bless this bread and bless this cup. When we hold these gifts in our hands, let us see the peace offered to us in them. In our receiving them, may we prepare the way for your peace, which is for all people. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for us that we might become the body of Christ. Do this in remembrance of him. The cup of the new covenant, written upon our hearts by the Spirit of God. Do this in remembrance of Christ. I invite those who may comfortably do so to stand for the prayer of thanksgiving and parting hymn. God of hope, you have made us one in the body of Christ and nourished us at your table. Now send us forth to prepare the way for the coming of Christ into our world. Through us, may all people see your salvation and rejoice. Amen. The peace which Christ brings is beyond all comprehension, yet we can hold it in our hand. This Advent, may you hold the peace in your hand and in your heart, and allow it to bring a glow of God's light to everything your hand touches. Be well.